Anyway, how are you?
I'm well. I'm very well, thank you. How are you?
I'm good. Are
you chasing your hair?
Incredibly busy and running around like a maniac, or are you having life mixed with work, or?
I've been living lots of life and now just spending a few days talking to people about disobedience. But yeah, I've been living a life. Yeah, real life.
Is that, that's always seemed to have been something that's important to you.
Real
yes.
life?
Yes.
Yes, it's really important. Yeah, yeah. I think you need to live to be able to tell stories. I think if you just tell stories and make fiction and don't do any real living, for me anyway, my storytelling abilities might get a bit dry.
And do you spend much time thinking about where you are in your career and what this movie connects to this movie or any of that stuff? Are you?
No.
Just let it go.
I don't know how to have, it's very hard to have perspective on your own, what you just said.
Your body of work, your...
No, I can't think about that without laughing. I'm English, we don't think about our body of work, my body of work. We just don't do that, I don't think.
Well, you have to stay out of Hollywood, you have to stay out of Los Angeles enough to avoid that conversation, I guess.
I don't know. I mean, we could give it a go. We could try. I don't know. I don't really know how, though. Yeah.
When you were a small child, well, you I gather, see, in the process of doing this, I yeah. read some interviews that you wrote, you did actually for the last movie, where you were played a, apparently you had never played somebody Jewish before.
For my last movie?
For the two movies, I guess it's now two or three
oh,
movies
Oh, whatever,
ago.
Yeah, Denial. I was for my first Jewish yeah. character. Yeah, yeah, I'd never played a Jew.
And had you even thought of that before people started asking you at junkets? It sounded like...
No, I'd never thought about it. It's kind of like, yeah, it wasn't something that was on my in my thought process. Yeah, yeah. But I mean, Deborah Lipstadt is very, you know, I would say she identifies as Jewish. So her whole, she's just very, you know, of a religion, of a place, of Queens, or Upper West Side, I think she says. But I think it's Queens.
So did your process of, in terms of putting together the character... include that, or is it kind of...
For Denial?
Yes.
Well, I had her as my material. I was meant to be playing her, and the director had come from a documentary, really, and it was more like a documentary, so I was almost sort of... Something I never normally do is I sort of imitated her. So that was the job. That was the task.
Which yeah. is scary to do, or...?
Yeah, I mean, it's sort of, it's confining in a certain way. I think if I was doing it again, I'd make my own version of her. Mm. I mean, obviously, if you're playing like an icon, I've been offered a few times to play Elizabeth Taylor. I just thought of it as we were in the Burton room here. I guess it must mean Richard. And so if you're playing an icon that everyone knows, then you have to get them right, you know,
right.
get them down. But Deborah's not someone that, she's not like a household name.
So that idea doesn't appeal to you very much.
To replicate someone.
To create somebody who not, lived.
I mean, I'm open to it. I'm open to it. I think it's more freeing to be left totally to your imagination. Mm. Probably.
And digging into the Orthodox community for this movie, for Disobedience?
I didn't really have to dig into the Orthodox community. Naomi Alderman, who wrote the novel that the film is based on, she grew up in this community in Hendon, and then she left it and went to live in New York. So she's a bit like Ronnie, my character. I mean, she would say very different, but in that sense.
Right.
So we had the extraordinary access and point of view of someone who was born into it and lived it, loved it to a point, but then left. It was more Rachel McAdams and Alessandra Nivola had to really do the research because they were still in the community. My character's abandoned it. She's
right.
kind of cut it off like it's an extra limb. She's like, I've got nothing to do with this identity. I'm living in New York. I'm secular. I'm gay or bisexual. So when she goes back to the community, she's not very comfortable with it. So I didn't have to get into it in the way that they did.
Do you get, I mean, do you do process where you spend a lot of time researching and digging and going backwards, or do you try to stay within the realm of the material you're working with?
I think it's, well, I had the novel, I optioned the novel.
But I mean in general, not just in this particular case.
I do research, yeah. Yeah, I do. In this case, it was a lifetime. It would have been
right.
living 20 years in a community and then leaving it for 20 years. So the research for that would just have to be something that where my own life intersected with that. I mean, I grew up in North London, three stops on the tube from Hendon, Golders Green. Mm-hmm. So, but not in this community. I've left, I mean, I still actually go back to London a lot and I live there as well, but mm-hmm. I live in New York. There were things where my life and Ronit's life intersected, which is kind of did the job of the research. Can be just an act of the imagination. It doesn't have to be like watching doctors perform surgeries if you're a surgeon, which I would do to be a surgeon. But
so you would go to that length if you were playing a surgeon?
Oh yeah. Okay. Oh yeah. Yeah. Just to be able to believe it. And then when you meet a surgeon and you spend 2 hours with them, you realize, oh, I'm really similar to you. In fact, I could be you and you could have been me had something or other happened when we were younger. It's just that feeling of, I'm you. It's just that moment where you feel that you take flight from the confines of who you are and you escape into that, you identify.
So you're breathing in their space more than you're learning how to do a cross stitch or.
I'm breathing in their space, did you say?
Yes.
Like breathing in the space that they're occupying. I love that sentence, but I want to know what you mean.
Like the idea that you're in their,
yes.
That you see how they move within their
space.
Lives as opposed to
yes.
The detail of the job or whatever.
I think the detail of the job can be really fascinating just as a kind of ritualized behavior that take you out of the normal patterns of your own life. So watching someone perform surgery or watching a cop go through their daily routines at their office or in the cop car, you know, I've been on night rides with police officers and stuff. That's just, that helps you breathe in their space as well as just, I love that phrase. Yeah, you breathe in their space, exactly. Yeah, and then I think that's how actors feel. It's after very little time, you feel like you could easily be them living their life. Why not?
Well, you kind of have to, I think, for us to believe.
Yeah.
The character. I mean, it's always a fascinating thing watching actors because it's so, people play things that are so different than they are, and yet there has to be enough of them there.
Yes.
That we identify with as an audience to believe it.
Yes, there's almost all of you there, strangely, but all of you filtered through them. I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, probably there are bits you have to leave out, but yeah, you have to show up because you don't have anything else.
So do you carry that kind of thing with you over the, I mean, obviously you've done a lot of it over the years, but does it stick or do you kind of put it in the back file and have it to access when you need it as an actor, but don't have it affect your life very much or?
I definitely don't have like a back catalog of all the parts I've played instantly accessible. They've gone into the ether now, but during the playing of the role, I think is what you mean, I've definitely learned to, of course it affects you, it affects your dreams, it affects how you walk, stuff that you're not in charge of, like the unconscious stuff. But I definitely have learned to switch it on and off like a button. Like a skill. I think probably that comes from being a mom. You just can't go home as your character. It's like you just can't do that because your kid wants you.
So you did that before you were a mom?
I think I did. I wasn't really doing it consciously. It just was I was just leading a very selfish life. I could just do what I wanted and stay with the character. But I had to, I've learned to just, it, for me, actually, it only exists now between action and cut.
Hmm.
Yeah, in a way
right.
That I can, that's palpable. So action, you just drop in, and cut, you just drop right out.
And has the pleasure of it changed for you in that process, Jade?
There's much more pleasure because the moment between action and cut is so potent. I'm not saying it's potent to look at, but it feels potent to get that lost in not your life, in the life of the fiction. It's feels like freedom, which, strange because it's been scripted, but feels like freedom.
So is doing a smaller movie like Disobedience as opposed to a big machine movie at a studio better in that way, and that you get more there are fewer hours spent waiting in your trailer and between those moments?
Definitely the ratio of action to cut moments to waiting around is very high in favor of the acting moments on small movies, because there isn't time to do anything but do the acting. So yeah, that's joyous. Yeah.
And has producing changed things for you, or?
I mean, I think about 10 years ago, some really great producers came to me and asked me, you know, did I want to start a production company with them, and what stories did I want to tell? And I was just like, I didn't know. I mean, I really didn't know. I mean, I knew a script when it came along, if I liked it, but I didn't have a sense of finding material. I just didn't know how to do it. So it took me until about 3 years ago, and I suddenly started to think, oh yeah, I'm interested in this, that, and the other. And so now, you know, this is the first one that's made it to, that's finished,
right,
and to be viewed. But there's about six things that are in stages of development: stories, books, life stories, stuff like that. And I can't remember your question.
Well, just whether there's a satisfaction, I guess, in being a producer.
Yeah.
Is it different? Is it a different experience when the movie's done than as an actor?
I tell you, it's not a different experience between action and cut. So on the set. So in relation to Disobedience, I optioned the book, found the director, found the co-writer, was incredibly involved in the adaptation in terms of a written text, and then the filming began, and I was not involved in hiring of the DP, the set design, anything visual that was the film was completely Sebastian. I had nothing, no part in, and I became an actress, which was someone who, you know, in my mind anyway, doesn't say I really don't like the way the walls look on the set. It's like, that's the director's job,
right,
I feel. And then in the post-production, I was involved in, with other producers, in the edit, in the storytelling, you know, the film storytelling. And I love those before and after bits. It's like a like a completely different side of your brain. It's a, I don't know if it's a left or right or middle or back, but it's like other. And loved it, absolutely loved it. And yes, in terms of now it coming out, because it's been a three-year, like a pregnancy, like an incubation, you know, it's like a chart. Yeah, I'm very attached to it, and very involved. I also love just to be hired for a film and just do a job.
Right.
That's got its own pleasure too, less work.
And will still happen.
Yeah. I'm sorry, yeah.
Do you still have that panic? Do you still think they're not gonna hire you next week?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, I think all actors do. I think fear is, we need fear. If we were complacent, I'm not sure. I don't know.
I don't know. There's some actors who, I think they get to a position as you are in, and that feel like, you know, they're making choices. I mean, one of the things, always a conversation with young actors, is that they really aren't making choices. That they are kind of, they do the work they can do,
because
that's what gets offered to them.
Yeah, completely. And you're paying the bills, and it's like this job, that job. Yeah, you just take what you get.
But then you get to a position as you are in, and you get to be a bit more choosy and say no a lot.
Sure, yes. And it's learning what to say no to, I guess, is an art form. But, and then also, like, finding stories that I'm interested in as well, that, you know, giving birth to stories like this one. Yeah, it's really lucky me. What a great life.
Is there something that you find you connect with more than other things, or is it just the right thing hits you when you read it and boom, you're interested?
I think, in general, I'm interested in films that, stories where the woman's subjectivity is front and center. So it's not just, I mean, there could be great supporting roles where it's really colorful and interesting, but there's something about, you know, with this film, there's a wonderful male part too, but there's two women who are very much in relation to one another, front and center, and it's their subjective experience that, if you get to see a lot of a character, you get to see them in lots of different aspects of their life, not just, they don't become a type. Like, you know, Sebastian's film Gloria, or Fantastic Woman, you know, Gloria could have been like the granny, you know, or the auntie who's like trying to date, but she's front and center. And for 58-year-old women in the real world, their life and their sexuality is front and center. That's the life they're living. But in stories, they often get pushed to the margins. Trans women, mm-hmm. like Fantastic Women, obviously have been very pushed to the margins in representation. And I would say bisexual and lesbian, Orthodox Jewish women also haven't been front and center. There's something about Sebastian and I connected of like, well, what's it like to be, really be these people? And in answer to your question, I guess transgression I'm interested in stories. The kind of delight of transgression, the delight of disobedience. So the stories that there are things that you're not supposed to do and the rules of society forbid you from doing, and seeing a character transgress in a delicious way, in a way that's important. To be disobedient, I think, is very important, particularly in stories.
Has that become more so for you, or is that always kind of...
I think it's always been there, but I don't think I could have articulated it 10 years ago. It's always been in my spirit, definitely. Right. But to actually know what story it is you like and want to tell, that's like, I don't know, different moment.
Well, you've made choices that are not erratic, is not the right word.
I think erratic would be okay. Yeah.
It does sometimes, you're like, there's a picture of coming up and you're like, how did she end up in that? How did that possibly happen?
I hear you. Yeah, well.
But you want to push. You like pushing.
Well, now I feel, I don't know. I don't know if it will look less erratic or more erratic, but I think it might be meditations on the same thing. I don't know.
It's interesting because I was noticing as I was going through your list of films that you have not yet played. You've played a mother, I guess. Have you played a mother?
About a boy. I played a mum. I was quite young. Yeah.
Yeah, but you didn't.
Nicholas Holt.
To Nick Holt. You're back doing another movie. Yeah,
we did The Favourite together. He's all grown up and just delightful. What a delightful actor. Yeah, and human. Anyway.
But you've not moved into Emma Thompson land or Meryl Streep land, where it's like you're the senior figure in anything yet. You're still, over 20 plus year career now, you're still playing young, vibrant, sexually active, whatever, women. You're not, you've managed to make, I'm not making any sense at all, am I? Managed to be the girl. Usually women move through an age thing through Hollywood or through the system, the world that we go through, and their careers change and they get to a point where they start playing mothers and they start playing grandmothers. They start playing. You've kind of found other more interesting roles that are not about that.
Yeah. I'm totally down with playing mothers, but, not if that's the sole definition of the role, So... There's a film that I'm developing that's not quite ready yet, but based on a book called Crooked Heart, and it's sort of tonally and in many ways an homage to Paper Moon, but it's a mother-son rather than a father-daughter, but they're not actually related, and she's a small-time crook, a woman, and it's a boy who becomes her accomplice, and they're kind of... It's a delightful comedy about, like in Paper Moon, you're just rooting for the, they're criminals basically, but you're rooting for them. So it's about kind of a delicious transgression. But she is a sort of a mother figure, but she's not like, she can give birth to him, raise him at home. And I don't know, stories.
Well, I think part of what I meant is more of an authority figure, I guess.
An authority figure?
Yeah. You've played women of authority, but you don't play, the authority figure female, yet.
The in The Favourite, I think I'm an authority figure.
Oh, well, there
you go. Hasn't come out yet, but not in a maternal way. She's like, she's no joke. But yeah, we'll see. I haven't seen it yet, so.
But you stayed young. You've stayed movie young.
In my spirit.
Even as you get older, well, you're slowly closing in on 50.
Yeah, it's
so
happening.
It's going to happen eventually. Yeah. Nobody seems to have noticed.
I mean, I guess, thank you, I suppose. I don't know. I mean, I don't know what to say.
So, Sebastian. That choice.
Yes.
I mean, obviously, Fantastic Woman has now made him a hot commodity around town and all of that.
Yeah.
But you made that choice before that all blew up.
Yes.
What was it about the, because the movie is very, it's the kind of material that's very susceptible to being over the top or being, you know, too Hollywood. I mean, you can definitely like make it into a structured piece, and this feels much more like a, not an improvised movie, but like a breathing, mm-hmm. intimate documentary like mm-hmm. film. Was that the choice with him? Was that there was something about him that, did you guys discuss that? Was there a sense that he was going to go that way, or?
No, I didn't ever ask him to pin down the tone or the style. I would never do that to a director. I just knew that he wanted a sense of reality, that these are real, living, breathing people facing huge conflicts, challenges in their life with their identities and their sexuality and their faith and, you know, really huge, massive, big existential questions. What I loved about him was, you know, he's from Latin America, he's Catholic, he's straight, he's a man, and he read this book, and the themes of kind of like disobedience, obedience, existential self-determination, freedom, identity, they spoke to him. From where he was sitting, it wasn't that he knew anything about this community. And I felt the same way about the story. So I think we felt the same way about that, yeah. But I would never, I'd seen his films and I saw that he's also interested in playing with genre, I think, a little bit, I would say. Like Fantastic Woman goes from, you know, it's a thriller and then it's a romantic film, and then there's like a musical trope. And I think he's like got like a little bit of a postmodern playfulness. But no, I would never like pin him down. It's he's an auteur. I respect directors. I think often they wouldn't even be able to explain in advance what it is they were going to breathe into the story.
That connection, that's your just trust.
Yes, yes, you have to trust. Yeah, yes, yes. Yeah, it's film is really a director's medium. My job is always the same. I just have to show up and try and be real, mm-hmm. I think, even if it's, you know, in a film like Lobster, which is highly stylized from the director's point of view, I was just trying to be react real in a real way to the craziness of what was happening. But yeah, so I don't get involved with the director in that way. I don't make them explain themselves, because I find that if I'm acting and someone tries to make me explain myself, I'm going to fuck up. It's just like you can't explain. It's unconscious, mainly.
So you don't want to, you want to think about it enough till you're ready to stop thinking about it and just be?
Exactly. I think about it and then I absolutely stop. And then once I'm doing it, I can't even talk about it. It was lovely. Rachel McAdams works in a really similar way. Really similar way. She I think, spent 6 months going deep into her research, which she had to do a lot. Obviously, she's not English, she's not Jewish, none of those things. It was a journey, and she just showed up, and she was Esty. She was right there. But we never said, what do you think about this, ever, ever. We never discussed anything. We just kind of do it,
had such a fascinating career, because those opportunities for her to kind of play the Hollywood side of it, she just is kind of eschewed and made other choices,
yep.
and seems to be just deeply passionate about disappearing into character.
Yep, she really is. She's really remarkable. I'm so massively, massively impressed, it was a wonderful working experience.
And everybody thinks Alessandro's English, even though he's not.
I know, because he's done so many English parts. Yeah, we met 20 years ago on a Michael Winterbottom film called I Want You, where he was English, yeah.
Well, they think he's English, and they think Emily's American.
Yeah, I know, right?
It's funny. Because they see her in the newsroom, I guess, but yeah. Whatever. But it's very strange, always been a strange relationship.
We were talking about, like, being, thinking, directors. Did I trust Sebastian to, you know, I didn't know what kind of movie it was going to be.
So do you want the direct, when directors hire you, is their trust of you and their willingness to kind of let you, do you want them to let you have space, or do you want them to take hold sometime?
I mean, I need not to analyze it once we're filming, but I think direction is a kind of, it's tone control. So with these kinds of directors that I love working with, like Sebastian or Yorgos, it's like everyone's tonally in the same world. And that's no small feat. That's like, it amazes me when directors can do that, that somehow everyone's in the same tone, or he's deliberately decided to shift tone in this moment. I mean, how do they do that? It's extraordinary. So it's like kind of like guiding I can't think of the analogy, but like a little ball into a onto a path. So you definitely need to be tone controlled.
And you can feel when that happens on a set.
You can feel it. Yeah. You can feel it. It's good. It's good feeling. It's not intellectual. It's just kind of a, I don't know how they do it. I don't know.
So when something's working on a show, you know it's working?
No, I mean, you don't always know. No. Sometimes I've done things and I just thought, well, that just didn't feel... sometimes it feels right and it's not right. Sometimes it, you know, because that's just all to do with the director and the edit and how... what tone they're after. I can't act in a tone. I don't know how to do... I don't think...
Right.
It's not something you can actually do.
Tone.
You can't act tone, but you can direct tone. So somehow... That's what I think great directors do.
So when you did Lobster, for instance, did you need to know what it actually all meant?
No, I did not.
Or did you just
ask.
Worry about your character? And
I just tried to play the truth of the moment and my character. And that was more than enough to be getting along with. It was a challenge. It was very challenging, but an interesting challenge. Yeah.
And you went back to Yorgos again. You shot another movie with him.
Yes, I would work with him. Whenever he likes, yeah.
Because it's just the experience is a pleasure.
It's unique. It's unique. I wouldn't say it's all pleasure. It's unique. It's challenging, and he's. It's mysterious. It's kind of like being lost in the woods. I mean, in Lobster, that was actually literally true. We were in the woods in Ireland, but there's a way in which he leads you to be lost in the woods, so you're not really in charge of your craft, shall we say, not at all. Yeah, and he's not really interested in that. He's interested in something outside of that. I don't know if I'm even right about this, because I don't know, we've never discussed it. He doesn't analyze what he does, but I think he's interested in things that are performances that are very unconscious, so not you doing good acting.
Well, I think he wants the audience to also kind of lose their brains and intellect.
Yeah.
Because you can't process. Trying to process it is very challenging.
It's very challenging. Yeah, it's really interesting. His film Dogtooth, which I saw before I did Lobster, I wanted to work with him. Rather like Sebastian, I sought him out after I saw Dogtooth. I just said, please can we meet? Please can we work together? So that's how that happened. So it was an active desire on my part.
So has it been consistent? It sounds like you're kind of at a place where you have your hand on it. You figured it out. You kind of know what you want to be doing and are finding ways to do it.
Yeah, I think that's a really fair assessment. I think I know what my taste is and which kind of people I'd like to work with. And, you know, some of those things will, you know, you never know if a movie's going to work or not. But I.
And so it's taken these years to grow into that knowledge, or did you always just kind of have it and just couldn't express it, or?
I don't know. I think it probably took a little time, yeah, to know, to be able to see the wood for the trees. Mm. Yeah, I think so. Yeah, but you know, it was lovely. I've worked with some incredible people before I even knew how talented they were, you know, worked with some wonderful, wonderful directors. So, yeah, sometimes there's instinct without knowledge. Yeah.
I was talking, I'll drop a name, Michelle Hanavicius the other day.
To who?
Michelle Hanavicius, who did the artist and has a movie about Godard that's coming out shortly here. That's very funny. It's a comedy.
Yeah.
But it was kind of like that. You keep on seeing these filmmakers. Like Fernando and like Yorgos coming here and then kind of leaving to go to their work again. Like you.
Do you mean like Fernando Morales?
Yes.
Yeah.
Like you come to Hollywood and you know, there's, it's such a beacon.
Yeah.
And then you realize you can't do that work that you want to be doing,
yeah,
and that they clearly want to be doing, and yeah, that has all that kind of intensity and passion, and is not right on the nose,
yeah,
in this town so much.
I guess not. Although Yorgos's new film, The Favourite, is Fox Searchlight,
right?
So that's from a lot, you know, from some,
yeah,
very clever group of people down the road, and.
Well, they figure out how to give them some money after a while.
Yeah, yeah.
But those even that tends to dissipate at some point. It's a weird thing.
Mm. I love The Shape of Water.
Yes. Well, Guillermo has his own
yeah,
space on the universe.
Yeah.
He's undeniable.
I see that this movie, obviously, is a completely different genre, but I see it as a cousin of Shape of Water, in that finding the freedom to love who you want to love. You know, in Guillermo's film, obviously set in the 60s or the 50s?
Yes.
60s, yeah.
I think both.
You know, and it's a woman of color who's experiencing racism, a homosexual man who can't be out. You know, the society's saying you can't be who you want. And I love Sally Hawkins. Sally Hawkins is a mute. I mean, you know, obviously seen it, you know the story, but they're all trying to live their lives and be free. And this creature that everyone says, this is grotesque, and he's a god. I mean, he's a beautiful god, but people can't understand it. I see this film a bit like that. It's like a meditation, like a non-fantasy version of how can you be free to love who you want.
Well, I think it's interesting because the religious element of it is not really the center of it.
No,
it's really the people and the just anything that tries to keep you within a suction, and you know, sucked into that universe.
Yeah.
Whether it's just your family, or whether it's a religion, or whether it's...
Well, it could have been a Mennonite community or an Amish community. I kept thinking when I read the book about Witness. Do you remember the Harrison Ford movie from the 80s with Kelly McGillis? And it's like, not free to love who, you know, she wasn't free to love.
Right.
I mean, it's a very different movie. It's, you know, the great white man coming to the rescue. But still, it's like, yeah. How can you, and Fantastic Woman, she's not free to love the man that she, even though he's dead, but she's trying to honor the man she loves and she can't. It's like, it's a very moving theme, I think.
Yeah, well, even the lesbianism of it, it's just, it's not, it's about these two, I feel like it's about these two women being what they are, as opposed to it's a story about, you know, lesbians or about whatever. It's like all those things become are the stamped on it, you know, as you go through it. But it's really subtle in the other ways. It's not, as I said before, it's the kind of thing where you could lean on those things.
Yes.
And I have had relationships with Orthodox community and went through that when I was a kid.
Really?
And so I recognize all of that very clearly. But at the same time, it didn't feel like the movie, you know.
Absolutely, it's not ideological. It's not hitting you over the head with the ideology. And I think a lot of gay women that I've spoken to feel very warm about being represented. It's a wonderful thing. I mean, if you're someone of color or you're someone living who's not represented in mainstream storytelling, I think it's a wonderful feeling. But I think if you're not a gay woman, I think it transcends its identity politics, both in religion and, you said it better than I could, I think it's universal. It's about, probably, just about how can you be free? And if you're slightly a misfit, how do you, freedom. It's just about freedom. It's a beautiful idea, freedom, I think.
Have you seen the documentary, One of Us, yet?
I haven't. I hear it's amazing.
It's pretty amazing. But it's the same thing. I mean, it's like four or five different stories that are all completely different kinds of people, but it's the same in spirit.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of fascinating. Just the effort to escape and the fear of the group to lose somebody.
Yes.
Is bigger than the individual, which is horrifying.
Yeah, but then there's a lot to be said for community. I understand that there was Sandy Dabowski did those documentaries, Trembling Before God. I mean, it's like Esty's character. She really believes in God. She really is an Orthodox Jew. She needs God. She needs it, but she's gay. And what that tussle, she said a really beautiful thing to me. She said, she said, Rachel said this to me. She said, Esty finds a loophole, which I thought was brilliant because I felt it was such a Jewish way of thinking. It's like a Talmudic loophole, you know. She finds a loophole and she realizes that God, she's free in God's eyes to disobey, and that he'll still love her. I just thought it was a, I just love her description of it being a loophole, that she can leave and be Jewish and be gay. It's a loophole.
Well, I think the Talmudic process is that whole thing. I mean, it's all a rationalization, ultimately.
It is.
Of an idea and somebody separating from the actual core idea, the Torah.
Yes.
And, you know.
It's an interpretation.
Discussing and rationalizing this way or that way.
Yes.
Which is what we all do in our lives every day.
Yeah. Is I see it like this, and I disagree with you, but this is how I see it. This is my interpretive truth. Yeah. Yeah. She became a Jew in that moment, Rachel McAdams. Don't you think?
Yes. Well, it's always so close. It's funny because you find out this person's Jewish or not Jewish, or you thought was Jewish, and then it doesn't matter. It's like, you know, Italians and Jews are barely recognizable from one another as it is.
So I agree. Italians and Jews. I feel, yeah, it's very true.
But other people.
Italians. Everyone's Jewish. No one's Jewish.
Exactly. Well, that's if you talk to the right Christians.
Oh, yeah. Jeez.
They're Jewish, too.
Jews for Jewish. Jews for Jews.
Even the Christians, Jesus was a Jew. So yeah. Therefore, yeah. It's a weird...
Yeah, there's Jews for Jesus as well, which is a different
Which is a whole other rationalization,
yeah.
Which I think a Jew for Jesus is a Christian, but that's a whole other conversation.
We'll have to leave that to another time.
I never understood that one at all. Thank you so much for your time.
Oh,
lovely seeing you.
Thank you. It's really lovely to see you.
Happy disobedience.
Thank you.